Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The War Against the Jews, 1933-1945 by Lucy S. Dawidowicz. Narrated by Suzanne Toren. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to visual elements present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Introduction to the 10th Anniversary Edition. In the 10 years since this book first appeared, a vast number of books and articles about the murder of the European Jews have been published. Nevertheless, this book continues to be favorably received by English speakers throughout the world and has been published in French, German, Hebrew, and Japanese as well. For this new edition, I have supplemented the original list of sources with a bibliography culled from the publications of the past decade, and I have corrected typographical errors. Apart from this, I have chosen not to alter anything that I wrote. In the intervening years, little new documentation has been unearthed from the rubble of National Socialist Germany. In 1983, the whole world was electrified by the news that 60 volumes purporting to be Hitler's handwritten secret diaries had been discovered. Some very eminent historians vouched for their genuineness, while other equally eminent historians disputed and ridiculed that claim. It didn't take long before the diaries were proved to be a clumsy forgery. The new evidence that has come to light since my book first appeared provided some interesting items of documentation, but none can be described as significant finds in terms of changing our views of the National Socialist past. Indeed, this additional evidence has further strengthened and corroborated my account of the war that the German dictatorship under Adolf Hitler waged against the European Jews. When I wrote The War Against the Jews, 1933-1945, I undertook to do three things. First, I wanted to present a coherent account of how it came about that National Socialist Germany succeeded in murdering 6 million European Jews. This is part one, the final solution. Next, I wished to show how the Jews, first in Germany proper and then in Eastern Europe, in Poland and Lithuania particularly, responded to the assault that was directed first against their rights, then against their livelihoods, and finally against their lives. This is part two, the Holocaust. Finally, I provided the appendix, The Fate of the Jews in Hitler's Europe, to give a concise, factual overview, country by country, of the murder of the European Jews. To lay the foundation for the historical account in the first part of the book, I began where this story must begin, with Hitler and with the irrational views of the Jews which shaped his mental universe. I tracked the development of Hitler's ideology from the start of his political career, examining his utterances on Jews as expressed in his speeches, articles, and books, until his final political testament, which he dictated just before his suicide. Next, in an attempt to explain how this uneducated fanatic emerged out of the German political landscape to become the Führer of the German nation, I offered a capsule history of German nationalism and of the racist anti-Semitism that first intruded into Germany's politics in the 1870s and soon became its most enduring staple. In time, the German people became habituated to the uninterrupted presence of anti-Semitism and came to accept it as a familiar element of their political discourse. The conventional anti-Semitism of those days, as it appeared in the planks of several political parties, advocated stripping the Jews of their newly gained political rights, barring them from public office, forbidding them to teach in Germany's schools and universities, excluding them from participation in the country's cultural and intellectual life, and restricting further Jewish migration into Germany. But Hitler, from his earliest days, preached a new and radical form of anti-Semitism, in ambiguous and esoteric language, calling for the removal or elimination of the Jews. To those who were not among the early insiders of the National Socialist Party, his anti-Semitic goals sounded unexceptional, indistinguishable from the conventional anti-Semitism to which most of them subscribed. In the years right after the First World War, many Germans could not reconcile themselves to their country's defeat. Blinded by nationalist arrogance, they could not concede even the possibility, let alone the grim reality, that Germany's resources had, in the end, been exhausted. These Germans had, in fact, become so deluded as to believe that their nation had been defeated only because of a stab in the back. A conspiratorial betrayal by Jews, in their eyes, the arch-conspirators of history. It is no wonder, then, that these people were prepared to accept Adolf Hitler as their political leader. In the book's next five chapters, I undertook to describe, stage by stage, how the German government under Hitler and his National Socialist Party began to carry out, by all means available to them, law, more correctly pseudo-law, violence, terror, those ideas that Hitler had salvaged from the rubbish heap of German anti-Semitism and elaborated on, first in Mein Kampf, and then in his second book, unpublished during his lifetime. The closing chapter of Part 1 summed up the documentary evidence I had presented in the earlier chapters, setting forth my interpretation of how Hitler's fantastic idea to murder the European Jews came to be realized with deadly efficiency. It has been my view, now widely shared, that hatred of the Jews was Hitler's central and most compelling belief, and that it dominated his thoughts and his actions all his life. That obsession led him, very early in his life, to latch on to the mad notion that the solution to the Jewish problem could be achieved only by radical means, literally by eliminating, that is, murdering, the Jews. It became his fixed idea, one to which he remained steadfast all his life. From the start, the idea to murder the Jews was just an inchoate phantom inhabiting Hitler's mind. But after he came to power and began to carry out the blueprint for Germany that he had drafted in Mein Kampf, that idea began to develop in stages, synchronized with his other notions for the restoration of racial purity in the German people. The documents amply justify my conclusion that Hitler planned to murder the Jews in coordination with his plans to go to war for Lebensraum, living space, and to establish the Thousand-Year Reich. The conventional war of conquest was to be waged parallel to, and was also to camouflage, the ideological war against the Jews. In the end, as the war hurtled to its disastrous finale, Hitler's relentless fanaticism in the racial ideological war ultimately cost him victory in the conventional war. In Part 2, The Holocaust, I described the Jewish response to National Socialist Germany's savage onslaught. I undertook to show how the Jews in the ghettos of Eastern Europe adapted the complex variety of institutions, traditional as well as modern and secular, that had been in place long before the war, to operate under the exigent conditions of German occupation. The representative communal organizations were transformed, under duress, into the Judenräte, the Jewish councils set up by the SS to administer the ghettos. Other pre-war communal institutions, social welfare, educational, cultural, religious, carried on as self-help agencies in the ghettos, sometimes legally, more often clandestinely. Most of the pre-war Jewish political parties evolved into an oppositional underground, and eventually into a resistance movement. In summing up part two, I demonstrated that the experience of Jewish history and of past Jewish persecution was utterly inadequate as a guide for the Jews who now confronted a new phenomenon in their history, a powerful nation that had committed its energies and resources to their total annihilation. Furthermore, I wanted to explain how few were the resources the Jews could mobilize, and how much fewer still were the opportunities available to them in their doomed struggle against the power of National Socialist Germany. In the decades before this book was published, controversies about Jewish behavior under Nazi rule had generated a lively debate among scholars as well as the general public. One argument centered on the charge that the Judenräte collaborated with the Nazis. Another revolved around the accusation of Jewish passivity. These debates stimulated further research and eventually produced new scholarly works. Though the new scholarship was to some degree spurred by Jewish defensiveness, the more important works, for instance, Isaiah Trunk's Judenrat, bore little trace of apologetics and were faultlessly objective. By the 1980s, these debates had all but disappeared from serious scholarly discussions. The allegation that Jews had collaborated with the Nazis persists, mainly in the controlled Soviet press, and has become a staple of communist anti-Semitic propaganda in the last decade. It has also penetrated into the propaganda of Arab and Third World countries, where Israel is a term of abuse and Zionist a code word for Jew. A new scandal confronting historians of the Holocaust erupted in 1977. After one Arthur R. Butts, an associate professor of electrical engineering and computer sciences at Northwestern University, had published a book called The Hoax of the 20th Century, which claimed that the Jews of Europe had not been exterminated and that there was no German attempt to exterminate them. Though this book was clearly the product of an unhinged mind, the author's university connection aroused public furor. Capitalizing on the notoriety generated by Butz's views, Liberty Lobby, the largest and best-financed anti-Semitic organization in the United States, set up a new front operation in Torrance, California, called the Institute for Historical Review. This institute, camouflaged as a scholarly institution, took on the task of denying the historicity of the Holocaust. Using the talents of anti-Semitic writers with far-out notions of historical reality, many of them from abroad, the Institute in 1979 launched the first of a series of annual pseudo-scholarly meetings that were parodies of bona fide academic conferences. In 1980, it began publishing a pseudo-scholarly quarterly, Journal of Historical Review. The Institute has tried repeatedly to win academic legitimacy, mostly by frequent mail canvasses of the memberships of professional historical associations. This denial of the Holocaust's historical reality particularly exercised the survivors of the camps, who saw it as an attempt to erase from historical memory the evidence of their terrible experiences. Some of the writers and scholars among them soon began to produce articles, pamphlets, and books, mostly of an apologetic character, proving that Auschwitz, Belzec, Chełmno, Majdanek, Treblinka, and Sobibór did exist. Almost as outrageous and provocative a view of the murder of the European Jews appeared in David Irving's book, Hitler's War, published in 1977. Irving, an amateur historian notorious for his disregard of truth or accuracy, described Hitler in this book as probably the weakest leader Germany has known in this century. Irving further asserted that Hitler had not wished to murder the Jews, had not ordered them to be murdered, and that those murders were committed without his knowledge or approval. The killing of the Jews, Irving wrote, was partly of an ad hoc nature. what the Germans call a Verlegenheitslösung, the way out of an awkward dilemma, chosen by the middle-level authorities in the eastern territories overrun by the Nazis, and partly a cynical extrapolation by the central SS authorities of Hitler's anti-Semitic decrees. Irving claimed that his conclusions were based on new evidence that he had uncovered, but in fact, his case rested on only one document, which he willfully misread. Readers of his book were especially affronted by his apologia for Hitler. Most recently, Irving's defense of Hitler has degenerated into a species of black comedy. Speaking before the Institute for Historical Review in Anaheim, California, in early September 1983, Irving said that the biggest friend the Jews had in the Third Reich, certainly when the war broke out, was Adolf Hitler. While no reputable historian has ever offered so bold a whitewash of Hitler as has Irving, revisionist portrayals of Hitler, intended to normalize him, are not new. As far back as 1961, the English historian Alan J.P. Taylor, already regarded then as an aging enfant terrible of the profession, argued in his book, The Origins of the Second World War, that in principle and in doctrine, Hitler was no more wicked and unscrupulous than many other contemporary statesmen. Furthermore, Taylor insisted, Hitler had no clear-cut plan and instead was a supreme opportunist, taking advantages as they came. To be sure, Taylor distinguished Hitler from those other statesmen by his wicked deeds, a conclusion Irving would likely dispute. Taylor's book sparked considerable controversy among professional historians, though his views were largely discounted because of the selectivity with which he used historical evidence. But in the last decade or so, a new faction of historians in Germany has produced a crop of books and articles propounding revisionist views of Hitler, National Socialist Germany, and even of the Final Solution that are as provocative as Taylor's, as implausible as Irving's, and as offensive as Butz's. How could this have happened? Each generation, as we all know, rewrites the history of the past according to its own values and standards. But could it have been predicted that a group of historians would presume to sweep into the dustbin of history works that their colleagues had produced just a decade or so before? Yet this is what has been happening in German historical scholarship, and its effect is being felt elsewhere, too. After the collapse of National Socialist Germany, a new cohort of German historians came to maturity. Unlike the historians who had preceded them, they offered no apologia to explain Germany's adventure into National Socialism. In their vanguard was Fritz Fischer, whose book on Germany's war aims in the First World War attested to the continuity of German history from the Wilhelmine Empire down to the Nazi era. Because they integrated the National Socialist era into the long line of German history, these historians were labeled in their time as revisionists. They uncovered the sources of National Socialist ideas and ideology in the German past and traced their evolution into the policies and practices of National Socialist Germany. They were the first to succeed in confronting Germany's terrible past and to delve unflinchingly into the record of its brutal politics and murderous racism. The historical works that they produced, most notably Karl Dietrich Brachel's The German Dictatorship and Eberhard Jäckel's Hitler's Weltanschauung, together with a host of other books, all models of methodological integrity and critical scholarship, were energized by that necessary measure of moral passion that distinguishes all great history. It seemed that these historians had erected a secure foundation for the history of the Hitler era. Then came the student riots of 1968 in Germany. The new left politics that overwhelmed the universities soon radicalized students and faculty as well. A school of historians came to the fore who undertook to revise drastically the scholarship about the Nazi era that had been produced in the late 1950s and 1960s. Thus, they became known as neo-revisionists. Political differences have mainly accounted for the division between the two groups of historians, revisionists versus neo-revisionists, but the surface debate between them has been over historical method and interpretation, specifically about structuralism. It was an approach in vogue among those historians on the left who, having rejected the Marxist approach because its economic determinism and dogmatism on class conflict were too rigid, took on, instead, a more up-to-date version of social determinism. The neo-revisionists, impressed by theoretical ideas derived from the structuralist movement, undertook to interpret the National Socialist past by applying the concepts of system, structure, and function, which they borrowed from sociology and anthropology. Critics of structuralist theory, however, believe that the measures of system, structure, and function are too static to do justice to the dynamics of history. They argue further that history is made by men and women, not by structures, that it is people who create, operate, and destroy structures. Furthermore, people are moved to action not by structures, but by their ambitions, intentions, and goals. They are motivated by ideas, values, beliefs, and the force of passion. One of the earliest influential structuralist works was Martin Broschat's Der Staat Hitlers. In this book, he ventured to correct what he described as the oversimplified picture of the National Socialist state as a monolithic system and a well-oiled superstate. He examined the internal power structure of the Hitler state, studying how the structures of the pre-Nazi state apparatus were merged or coordinated with those of the Nazi party, and how they operated in the light of the Führer principle governing Hitler's Germany. According to that principle, which Hitler himself conceived in the days of the party's infancy, all power emanated from him, the Führer, and he delegated authority downward to his deputies and satraps. In areas where, for one reason or another, Hitler failed to establish a clear authority, a bureaucratic jungle of competing jurisdictions sprang up. Personal rivalries, conflicts over interests and power, intrigues and conspiracies then developed among the Nazi loyalists in their scramble to win Hitler's approval. Broschat interpreted these rivalries and struggles for power in the Nazi hierarchy as the polycracy of individual office holders, each seeking to recommend himself to Hitler through a particular ability to get things done. He coined the term polycracy, rule by many, to explain how National Socialist Germany functioned. The common term for power sharing as conceived in classical Greek political theory is polyarchy. He painted a picture of the German dictatorship as a state ridden by chaos, anarchy, and competing rulers. It was a bizarre interpretation of National Socialist Germany. To be sure, some Nazis in high places ran their jurisdictions like private fiefdoms, but none ever shared power with Hitler or governed independently as a polycrat or a polyarch. In areas where Hitler failed clearly to articulate his wishes, his satraps vied with each other in trying to carry out the policies that they thought most satisfactorily reflected his wishes. None dared to carry out a policy that did not accord with Hitler's will. In repudiating what he called the growing tendency of historians to resort to the history of personalities, Broschat downgraded Hitler's role in the dictatorship. It was not Hitler alone who enforced absolute control, Brochat declared. That view of Hitler was to become an article of structuralist faith in interpreting Nazi Germany. Similarly, another structuralist, Hans Mommsen, argued in 1970 that Hitler was a weak dictator, a characterization predating David Irving's similar assessment. Hitler, Mommsen said, was easily influenced by those in his retinue. Denigrating Hitler as a man without program, Mommsen described him as a man of improvisation, experimentation, and spur-of-the-moment inspiration. The structuralists' devaluation of Hitler as a leader was in part a negative reaction to the recurrent waves of popular interest in Hitler and a protest against the portrayal of Hitler in the popular literature as the arch-fiend of history. But more importantly, the structuralists were persuaded by their theory, rather than by the evidence, to minimize Hitler's role in shaping the character of National Socialist Germany. For, like the Marxists, they minimize the role of personality in history, and instead regard social and economic processes as the determinants of history. If Hitler was not the absolute leader of National Socialist Germany, as the structuralists claimed, how then was the rule of his dictatorship enforced? Brochat had a ready explanation. Despotism, he wrote in his book, was the outcome of the regime's internal law of motion. That sentence, with its abstract nouns and impersonal construction, described a political system that we are unlikely to encounter in this world. Brochat evoked a science fiction fantasy of government by automation, robotistically driven by an internal law of motion, generating despotism without human intervention, without human leadership. This mechanistic interpretation of National Socialist Germany has become the hallmark of structuralist history. It is at variance with everything we have known and learned about that state for the last 50 years. The structuralists have defined the Hitler state as a system operated by the inertia of its bureaucratic structures, performing their functions mechanically, except when those functions have been impaired by the disorder, chaos, and anarchy produced by the indecisiveness of a weak leader. They regard political decisions as the byproducts of the state's structures or functions, and not as the expression of the will or intention of the state's leaders. Accordingly, no human agent can then be held responsible for decisions or for their consequences. The structuralists have thus eliminated the exercise of free will in human society and deprived men and women of their capacity to choose between good and evil. By removing the moral aspect of decision-making in the Hitler era, the structuralists initiated a new cycle of apologetics in German history. But this neo-revisionist history has not gone unchallenged in Germany. Some of the Federal Republic's most distinguished historians have been provoked to rebut the structuralist gospel. They have expressed their critical dissent with its historiographical method and their disapproval of the excision of the moral element from the history of National Socialist Germany. Karl Dietrich Brache, one of the sharpest critics of the neo-revisionists, charged that they would like to leave behind the questions of Germany's guilt and responsibility in favor of an allegedly modern, realistic analysis, but in so doing, they have fallen into the danger once again of underestimating and trivializing National Socialism. Not surprisingly, the structuralists advanced some bizarre interpretations also about the final solution of the Jewish question, the Nazi code name for the murder of the European Jews. Though their contributions to this field have been modest in quantity and in quality, their ideological fashionableness has ensured them a respectful hearing not otherwise warranted. The first work to apply structuralist theory to National Socialist Germany's anti-Jewish policies was Uwe Dietrich Adams' doctoral dissertation, Judenpolitik im Dritten Reich, 1972, which dutifully rehearsed the structuralist litany about chaos, competing jurisdictions, lack of direction, a weak and indecisive dictator. Like most structuralists who have been interested in the operation of bureaucracies, Adam restricted himself to domestic affairs. He made no attempt to explain the escalation of Nazi Germany's domestic anti-Jewish programs in terms of Hitler's foreign policy and his plans for war in the East. Yet Hitler, unlike the structuralists, was more interested in the pursuit of racial empire, war, and conquest than in the operation of bureaucracies. By forcing a random assortment of evidence into his structuralist framework, Adam concluded that the Jewish policy of the Third Reich was not planned in advance, and that Hitler merely reacted to the existing circumstances and did not create them himself. Nevertheless, Adam conceded, presumably in deference to the prevailing scholarship, that Hitler might have made a decision to murder the Jews. He dated that decision sometime between September and November 1941. Could one have expected that a responsible scholar would so urgently wish to accommodate the historical evidence to his theory that he would be prepared to suppress the essential facts? Adam expunged from the historical record the staggering statistic that by the end of November 1941, his date for Hitler's decision to murder the Jews, nearly a million Jews had already been murdered. That was mass murder on an unprecedented scale, carried out systematically and uniformly on a vast territory by four military formations called Einsatzgruppen. The men and officers of these Einsatzgruppen had been recruited and trained in May 1941 under the direction of Reinhard Heydrich, head of the security police. Hitler himself had delegated the authority for those killing operations to Heinrich Himmler, head of the SS. That authorization, dictated by Hitler, was written into a military directive issued by General Wilhelm Keitel, chief of the High Command of the German Armed Forces, on March 13, 1941, in connection with Operation Barbarossa, the code name for the invasion of the Soviet Union. In the last decade, the chief proponents of the structuralist interpretation of how the murder of the Jews came about have been Broschat and Mommsen, and their writings have appeared in German learned journals. Both have built their case on those contrary insights about the Nazi state for which we are indebted to the structuralists. Like Uwe Adam, they concentrated on the domestic aspects of the Jewish question and did not correlate it with Hitler's foreign policy and with the war in the East. They believed that there was no plan for the murder of the European Jews, but that it happened as a consequence of individual initiative and bureaucratic inertia. One is reminded of Topsy in Uncle Tom's Cabin, who just growed. Unlike Butz and David Irving, Broschat and Mommsen conceded that Hitler was driven by his anti-Semitic obsessions, and that historians must attribute to him some share in the responsibility for the murder of the Jews. But they have insisted that his anti-Semitism was no more than a propaganda ploy to rally popular support. Back in 1970, Broschat had already characterized the Jewish question in the Nazi state as merely the primary symbol of the ceaseless domestic struggle, denying that anti-Semitic propaganda in Nazi Germany had programmatic substance or practical consequences. Still earlier, in Der Staat Hitlers, Broschat offered a hypothesis that the anti-Jewish policies of Hitler's Germany, beginning with the use of legal discrimination against Jews within Germany and ending with the murder of 6 million European Jews, were unplanned. Even in the face of an impressive accumulation of scholarship to the contrary, Broschat and Mommsen have continued to hew to the structuralist dogma that Hitler's intentions and goal did not determine policy in National Socialist Germany. They have rejected the widely accepted view that Hitler's ideas and intentions, especially those concerning racial purity, racial empire, and the Jews, became the center of his political program and determined his plans for war and conquest. Mommsen even coined the term intentionalist, used pejoratively to distinguish those historians who believe that intentions have consequences for history from the functionalists who see the truth and properly assign the history-making role to structures and functions. Broschat, in an otherwise respectful review essay on David Irving's book Hitler's War, chided him for his preposterous notion that Hitler had no responsibility for the murder of the Jews. But he supported Irving's view about the so-called haphazard character of the mass murder and expressed his skepticism that Hitler had ever issued an order, thereby parting company from Uwe Adam. Broschat surmised that the destruction of the Jews more likely developed from individual actions, and paraphrased Irving approvingly. The destruction of the Jews began, so it seems, not only out of an alleged will to destruction, but as a way out of a blind alley into which one was maneuvered. Once begun and institutionalized, the process of the liquidation attained its dominant importance, and in the end did in fact evolve into a comprehensive program. Broschat's style, as we have seen, requires explication. What did he mean to say here? To whose alleged will to destruction was he referring? Who found a way out of what blind alley? Who began the process of liquidation, and who institutionalized it? What precisely was the dominant importance that the process of liquidation attained? Was that Broschat's allusion to the millions who were being murdered? Broschat's diction and syntax call to mind the propensities of German bureaucratic jargon for abstractions, weak and intransitive verbs, passive constructions, a jargon that gave birth to Nazi Deutsch, the language used in the chancelleries of Hitler's Germany. Those who have studied the Nazi documents that recorded the Hitler state's terrible crimes know how artful they were as exercises in equivocation and circumvention, in concealing rather than communicating, in evading the attribution of personal responsibility. Broschat admitted that he could not prove his interpretation with certainty, but he remained convinced that it was more plausible than the hypothesis that there had been a general secret order for the annihilation of the Jews. But those counterpoised alternatives are not the only historical possibilities. Indeed, no historian has, to my knowledge, speculated that Hitler ever issued such a general secret order. The only ones to clamor for such an order have been David Irving and those who deny that the Jews were murdered at all. They have challenged historians to produce such a general order, hoping that its absence will prove that Hitler had no hand in the murder of the Jews, or that the Jews were not murdered. In point of fact, a rich body of primary documentary sources exists to support the hypothesis, to which most historians subscribe, that Hitler had a general plan, as distinct from an order, for the murder of the Jews. There is ample evidence to prove, as this book does, that Hitler implemented his plan in stages, seizing whatever opportunities offered themselves to advance its execution. This interpretation tracks the course of Hitler's mind. It establishes how his ideas became intentions, how those intentions were converted into plans, how those plans were embodied into the Hitler state's policy, and how that policy was executed by the structures of the National Socialist state and party. This is an interpretation that makes the best sense of the accumulated evidence and that offers the most satisfactory explanation for that terrible sequence of events. The structuralist interpretation fails to convince because it takes no account of ideas and intentions, even such monstrous ones as Hitler's. For history begins in the minds of men and women, in the ideas they hold, and in the decisions they make. Every idea, Oliver Wendell Holmes wrote in a judicial opinion, is an incitement. History renders an account not only of battles and wars, elections and revolutions, intrigues and alliances, but above all, of the ideas, ambitions, and goals of the people who set those events in motion. The English historian and philosopher R.G. Collingwood made the distinction between the outside and the inside of an event. The outside of the event, he said, was its action. The inside was the thought of the agent of that action. To penetrate the inside of an event, the historian has to enter into the minds of the men and women whose actions make history and, in effect, recreate their thoughts. The minds of these agents of history are, to the historian, as important as any battlefield or house of a parliament. They are far and away the most strategic sites of history. But the structuralists will have none of this. They have imposed their theory on the outside of events. The inside of events has become the black hole of their historical universe. Because they use structures and functions to explain critical decisions made at historical junctures, structuralists cannot assign historical responsibility to their historical actors. They are consequently unable to make historical judgments. As for the history of the murder of the European Jews, the neo-revisionists have forced that history into the Procrustean bed of structuralist theory. Their account, as we have seen, explains nothing. It has, however, served their political interests. This was most evident in an essay in which Hans Mommsen propounded the structuralist interpretation of the murder of the Jews. Writing in that dense jargon we have come to associate with the structuralists, he concluded, "The Holocaust is not only a warning against racist phobias and social resentments directed against minorities. At the same time, it directs attention to the persistent danger also from advanced industrial societies, which takes the form of the manipulative crippling of public and private morality." Thus, the structuralists exploit the murder of the European Jews for their ideological views. The Holocaust has become just another stick with which to beat the Western world and to equate advanced industrial societies with National Socialist Germany. Still, it would be unfortunate if one were to think that the history of National Socialist Germany and of the Holocaust has become the property of the neo-revisionists in Germany or elsewhere. This new wave of structuralist historians has, in fact, failed to undermine the historical edifice erected in the last quarter of a century. That history has remained authoritative because of the integrity of its scholarship and its moral perspective on the German dictatorship. Most of the historians who produced that history are still at work. The discipline of history has, in its own long existence, withstood many assaults by those who would use the knowledge of the past for purposes other than knowing that past. From the days of the Bible on, partisans of one faction or another tried to enlist history on their side. In National Socialist Germany, the historical profession itself undertook to rewrite German history for the greater glory of Adolf Hitler and his Third Reich. In the Soviet Union, Stalin not only commanded the erasure of the past, but also prescribed how it was to be rewritten. The Soviet satellites, Poland especially, have become adept at historical erasure and revision. Yet history, as a way of knowing the past, has survived the partisanship, the ideological distortions, the attempts to extinguish its light, and even to murder its practitioners, and it will continue to do so. Its most terrible chapter, the murder of the European Jews, will surely remain forever recorded. Lucy S. Dawidowicz, New York City, 1984. The subject, definitions and contours. The annihilation of 6 million Jews, carried out by the German state under Adolf Hitler during World War II, has resisted understanding. The question persists, how could it have happened? That question embraces several questions, each charged with passion and moral judgment. They are: 1. How was it possible for a modern state to carry out the systematic murder of a whole people for no reason other than that they were Jews? 2. How was it possible for a whole people to allow itself to be destroyed? 3. How was it possible for the world to stand by without halting this destruction? Part 1 of this book, The Final Solution, attempts to answer the first question. Part 2, The Holocaust, attempts to answer the second. A partial answer or partial answers to the third question can be found in the appendix. The Final Solution of the Jewish Question was the code name assigned by the German bureaucracy to the annihilation of the Jews. The very composition of the code name, when analyzed, reveals its fundamental character and meaning to the Germans who invented and used it. The term Jewish question, as first used during the early Enlightenment emancipation period in Western Europe, referred to the question or problem that the anomalous persistence of the Jews as a people posed to the new nation-states and the rising political nationalisms. The Jewish question was at bottom a euphemism whose verbal neutrality concealed the user's impatience with the singularity of this people that did not appear to conform to the new political demands of the state. Since a question demands an answer, and a problem a solution, various answers and solutions were propounded to the Jewish question by foes and even friends that entailed the disappearance of the Jews as such, abandonment of the Jewish religion or its essential elements, of the Jewish language, Yiddish, of Jewish culture, Jewish uniqueness, and separatism. The histories of Jewish emancipation and of European anti-Semitism are replete with proffered solutions to the Jewish question. The classic illustration is the solution offered by Konstantin Pobyedonostsev, chief advisor to Tsar Alexander III in 1881. 1/3 of the Jews were to emigrate, 1/3 to convert, and 1/3 to die of hunger. To this concept that the National Socialists adopted, they added one new element, embodied in the word final. Final means definitive, completed, perfected, ultimate. Final reverberates with apocalyptic promise, bespeaking the last judgment, the end of days, the last destruction before salvation, Armageddon. The final solution of the Jewish question, in the National Socialist conception, was not just another anti-Semitic undertaking, but a meta-historical program devised with an eschatological perspective. It was part of a salvational ideology that envisaged the attainment of heaven by bringing hell on earth. The devil is loose, Friedrich Rekmalacheven noted in his diary on October 30, 1942. The most important event of our time, André Malraux said, was le retour de Satan, citing the German system of terror. To attain its heavenly hell on earth, the German dictatorship launched a war that engulfed the whole world. Over 35 million people were killed, more than half of them civilians. On the battlefields, one out of every 22 Russians was killed, one out of every 25 Germans, one out of every 150 Italians and Englishmen, and one out of every 200 Frenchmen. The human cost of 2,191 days of war surpassed the losses of any previous war in the world. That war brought death to nearly 6 million Jews, to 2 out of 3 European Jews. Though one-third of them managed to survive, though the Jewish people and Judaism have outlived the Third Reich, the Germans nevertheless succeeded in irrecoverably destroying the life and culture of East European Jewry. The final solution transcended the bounds of modern historical experience. Never before in modern history had one people made the killing of another the fulfillment of an ideology, in whose pursuit means were identical with ends. History has, to be sure, recorded terrible massacres and destruction that one people perpetrated against another, but all, however cruel and unjustifiable, were intended to achieve instrumental ends, being means to ends, not ends in themselves. The German state, deciding that the Jews should not live, arrogated to itself the judgment as to whether a whole people had the right to existence, a judgment that no man and no state have the right to make. Anyone who, on the basis of such a judgment, said Karl Jaspers, plans the organized slaughter of a people and participates in it, does something that is fundamentally different from all crimes that have existed in the past. To carry out this judgment, designated as the final solution, the German dictatorship involved and engaged the entire bureaucratic and functional apparatus of the German state and the National Socialist movement, and employed the best available technological means. The final solution destroyed the East European Jews. In doing so, it subverted fundamental moral principles and every system of law that had governed, however imperfectly, human society for millennia. In writing the history of the final solution, I approached the subject from the inside as best I could. Here the Germans are the actors, and their acts are viewed through the lenses of German documents. In dwelling on Hitler's ideas about the Jews and on the development of modern German anti-Semitism, I have tried to show the intellectual and historical origins of the final solution. Throughout, I tried to demonstrate the mutual influences and interplay of ideology and action, belief and program, national character and political behavior. Part 2, The Holocaust, describes the Jewish response to the final solution. The Holocaust is the term that Jews themselves have chosen to describe their fate during World War II. At the most superficial level, the word Holocaust means a great destruction and devastation. But its etymological substratum interposes a specifically Jewish interpretation. The word derives from the Greek holokauston, the Septuagint's translation for the Hebrew olah, literally, what is brought up, rendered in English as an offering made by fire unto the Lord, burnt offering, or whole burnt offering. The implication is unmistakable. Once again, in their history, the Jews are victims, sacrifices. The Holocaust then becomes another link in the historic chain of Jewish suffering. The very word summons up the remembrance of the Jews in 1096 during the First Crusade. The chronicles and liturgical poetry of those days, in a striking concurrence, evoke the image of the Akedah, the binding or sacrifice of Isaac, as the prefiguration of their own ordeals. For the Jews, the Holocaust did not transcend history, but was part of the recurrent pattern of persecution that has been the Jewish historic experience. Still, within the perspective of Jewish history, the Holocaust is the most massive and disastrous catastrophe since the earliest days of that history. Even at the time of the greatest Jewish national trauma, the destruction of the Second Temple, the physical survival of the Jews was not in such jeopardy as during the Holocaust. In 70 CE, only about one-fourth of the Jews lived in Palestine, while the rest lived in the diaspora. More Jews lived in Alexandria then than in Jerusalem. In 1939, in contrast, two-thirds of the world's Jews lived in Europe, and three-fourths of them, half of all world Jewry, were concentrated in Eastern Europe. The destruction of East European Jewry brought to an end the thousand-year-old culture of Ashkenazic Jewry that had originated in the Rhine Basin and that by 1939 was concentrated in Eastern Europe. It was a culture whose religious teachings and traditions defined its secular character and values. It was a culture whose language was Yiddish, the language in which Jewish males studied the Talmud, in which mothers sang lullabies and little children played games, in which merchants conducted business and preachers delivered sermons, in which shrews scolded and roughnecks cursed, in which young men courted their girls. Yiddish was a vehicle for a great religious and secular culture, and it generated a rich literature. East European Jewry created a culture that venerated the Sefer, the book of religious learning, but whose people laughed at themselves. It was a culture that put its people, familiar with poverty and hardship, on speaking terms with God. It was a culture unique in all Jewish history, and East European Ashkenazic Jewry, which fashioned that culture, was the wellspring of Jewish creativity for Jewish communities throughout the world. Part 2, The Holocaust, opens with a chapter about the German Jews in their encounter with National Socialism in the first stage of its rule. Thereafter, Part 2 focuses on the experiences of the East European Jews, mainly in Poland and Lithuania, because they were the most numerous of all European Jews, because they constituted a unique civilization, and because Eastern Europe was the central locus of the final solution. The primary task I set myself was to describe the responses of the organized Jewish community to the final solution in its several stages. I have stressed the role and functions of Jewish communal institutions and communal leadership at various levels in the reordered Jewish society under German occupation. To the best of my ability, and within the limits set by the availability of sources, I have tried to delineate the varieties of Jewish communal policy as formulated and carried out in different communities and by different communal leaders at various levels, sometimes in harmony and sometimes at variance with each other, and to show, wherever possible, the responses of the masses to these policies. Consistently, I have used Jewish sources as the lenses through which to view the Jewish community and to analyze Jewish behavior. One impediment was the inadequacy of Jewish documentation, despite its enormous quantity. Holocaust documents were composed under extreme persecution, and they are the quintessential products of external censorship and self-imposed restraints. Jewish official documents that have survived reflect the writer's awareness of the omnipresent Germans and their all-seeing eyes. The absence of vital subjects from the records may be explained by the predicament of terror and censorship. Yet, lacking evidence to corroborate or disprove, the historian will never know with certainty whether that absence is a consequence of an institutional decision not to deal with such matters, or whether it was merely a consequence of prudential policy not to mention such matters. The terror was so great that even private personal diaries, composed in Yiddish or Hebrew, were written circumspectly, with recourse to scripture and the Talmud as a form of esoteric expression and self-imposed reticence. Survivor documentation, on the other hand, frequently suffers from subjectivity, bitterness, and partisanship, commonplace and habitual defects of most historical records. These documents have a further shortcoming. For the most part, the experiences recounted by survivors bring to mind the adventures of Stendhal's Fabrizio del Dongo at the Battle of Waterloo. Like him, they are never quite certain what great events they are witness to. Like him, they have just missed seeing the emperor. In their case, they have been too distant from communal responsibility to be able to describe with any authority those critical situations at which significant decisions were made and policies framed for the Jewish community. With the liquidation of the ghettos, Jewish communal existence came to an end. Some 5, perhaps 10% of East European Jews lived a brief while longer in closed concentration labor camps, but no formal Jewish communal institutions existed anymore. A minuscule number of Jews, atomized individuals, managed to survive even the death camps. But their story is not the history of the Jewish community. For this reason, this book closes with the liquidation of the ghettos. The appendix, The Fate of the Jews in Hitler's Europe, is an attempt to put on record the essential bare facts about the Jews in each European country. Each country is considered individually, and its wartime status described. A sketch of that country's pre-war Jewish population follows, and then the course of the final solution in the country is briefly recounted. It was my intention here to provide, in a kind of historical shorthand, a summary account of the fate of the European Jews during World War II, and at the same time, within the limits of the presentation, to enable one to distinguish those political, historical, social, and geographic factors that accounted for the different treatment accorded to the Jews in various countries. This is not a value-free book. The very subject matter of the final solution precludes neutrality. In writing about a nation that transgressed the commandment, "Thou shalt not murder," it is impossible to be what Charles Beard characterized as a neutral mirror. Whereas the Germans, in planning and executing the final solution, played the role of the devil and his hosts, the Jews during the Holocaust were, alas, merely human, saints and sinners, imperfect earthlings. In writing about the Holocaust, I have tried to avoid moral judgments, though I have not hesitated to describe demoralization. In discussing the deeds of the handful of Jewish leaders who have been charged by survivors and scholars with criminal behavior, I have been persuaded by Professor Herbert Butterfield's view that the historian can never quite know men from the inside, because he can never carry his investigation into the interiority of their minds and hearts, where the final play of motive and the point of responsibility are decided. As best I could, I have tried to present what actually happened. I strove to follow the two methods that Wilhelm von Humboldt perceived to be the historian's task in the approach to the historical truth. The first is the exact, impartial, critical investigation of events. The second is the connecting of the events explored and the intuitive understanding of them which could not be reached by the first means. The War Against the Jews, 1933 to 1945. Part 1. The Final Solution. 1. The Jews in Hitler's Mental World. If at the beginning of the war and during the war, Hitler wrote in the last chapter of Mein Kampf, 12 or 15,000 of these Hebrew corruptors of the people had been held under poison gas, as happened to hundreds of thousands of our very best German workers in the field, the sacrifice of millions at the front would not have been in vain. Did the idea of the final solution originate in this passage, germinating in Hitler's subconscious for some 15 years before it was to sprout into practical reality? The idea of a mass annihilation of the Jews had already been adumbrated by apocalyptic-minded anti-Semites during the 19th century. Yet even the most fanatic and uncompromising anti-Semites, when confronted with political actualities and social realities, invariably settled for an aggregation of exclusionary measures. Hitler did not. He succeeded in transforming the apocalyptic idea into concrete political action. The mass murder of the Jews was the consummation of his fundamental beliefs and ideological conviction. The nexus between idea and act has seldom been as evident in human history with such manifest consistency as in the history of anti-Semitism. Jew hatred is one of those unit ideas, to use Arthur Lovejoy's phrase, with long life histories of their own. Yet not until Hitler's accession to power in Germany and his dominion over Europe had the abstract idea of Jew hatred assumed so terrible a concrete and visible reality. Nor had antisemitism ever before been so obviously a product of a system of beliefs. For Hitler's ideas about the Jews were the starting place for the elaboration of a monstrous racial ideology that would justify mass murder whose like history had not seen before. Only Hitler's followers took his ideas about the Jews seriously. His opponents found them too preposterous for serious consideration, too irrational and lunatic to merit reasonable analysis and rebuttal. Today, looking at his photographs, it seems easy to understand how Hitler could have been underestimated, disparaged. He was of medium height, with beady eyes and a comic mustache. The unmanageable cowlick of his pomaded hair became the burlesque symbol of unrestrained passion. He was a strutter and a posturer. "One of those men without qualities," wrote Konrad Haydn, "his face without radiance." Hermann Rauschning, too, characterized his look as lacking the brilliance and sparkle of genuine animation. An authority in racial biology described Hitler as he saw him in 1923, "face and head, bad race, mongrel, low receding forehead, ugly nose, broad cheekbones, small eyes, dark hair, facial expression not of a man commanding with full self-control, but betraying insane excitement. Finally, an expression of blissful egotism." "A raw vegetable Genghis Khan," wrote Friedrich Percival Rekmalachevin, observing Hitler without his usual bodyguard in a Munich restaurant in 1932. It would have been easy then, in the almost deserted restaurant, to shoot Hitler. "If I had had an inkling of the role this piece of filth was to play, and of the years of suffering he was to make us endure, I would have done it without a second thought. But I took him for a character out of a comic strip and did not shoot." A raving lunatic, a comic strip character, a political absurdity. Yet his voice mesmerized millions. A guttural thunder, according to Haydn, the very epitome of power, firmness, command, and will. Was it the sheer physical quality of the voice that hypnotized them? Or was the charisma in the dark message of racial mastery and the rule of blood? Serious people, responsible people, thought that Hitler's notions about the Jews were at best merely political bait for disgruntled masses, no more than ideological window dressing to cloak a naked drive for power. Yet precisely the reverse was true. Racial imperialism and the fanatic plan to destroy the Jews were the dominant passions behind the drive for power. Hitler's ideas about the Jews were at the center of his mental world. They shaped his worldview and his political ambitions, forming the matrix of his ideology and the ineradicable core of National Socialist doctrine. They determined the anti-Jewish policies of the German dictatorship from 1933 to 1945, and they furnished the authority for the murder of the Jews in Europe during World War II. Few ideas in world history achieved such fatal potency. If only because these ideas had such consequences, they deserve serious analysis, despite their irrationality, historical falsehood, scientific sham, and moral loathsomeness. Mein Kampf provides much of our knowledge about Hitler and his ideas. He wrote it in the prison at Landsberg while serving a highly abbreviated term, November 11, 1923 to December 20, 1924, of a 5-year sentence for high treason in organizing the unsuccessful Munich putsch. Graceless, prolix, disorganized, incoherent in parts, repetitious, Mein Kampf was written in the tradition of confessional biography, in which the hand of destiny is clearly seen to be shaping the course of the writer's life. It is, above all, a self-aggrandizing document in which the author is presented as intellectual nonpareil and political savior. Nothing was to detract from this image of Hitler, and consequently he suppressed mention of persons or events that molded and influenced him. As for his ideas, we can never really be confident that his descriptions in 1924 of the ideas he held in 1904 or 1908 or 1912 are honest, or whether he recreated his intellectual development swathed in legends. During his lifetime, Hitler's champions and enemies furnished additional bits and pieces to the sketchy information about his early life. Subsequent scholarship has yielded a few more details to the portrait of the authentic Hitler. Still, much mystery surrounds his origins and early life. Adolf Hitler was born April 20, 1889, in the town of Braunau on the Inn River at the Austro-German border, the fourth child of Alois Hitler and Clara, his third wife, 23 years his junior. Alois was the illegitimate son of Maria Anna Schickelgruber, 1795 to 1847, in whose name he had been christened. The identity of Adolf Hitler's paternal grandfather has remained an unraveled historical mystery of more than passing interest, since it raised doubts about Adolf Hitler's pure racial ancestry. Nearly all the evidence is in dispute. In 1842, when Alois was 5 years old, his mother married Johann Georg Hiedler, the family name variously spelled Hütler, H-U-T-T-L-E-R or H-U-T-L-E-R, and Hitler. Alois, however, seemed to have been brought up by Georg's younger brother, Johann Nepomuk, who, according to another version, was his real father. In 1876, when Georg was 84 years old, he formally acknowledged Alois, then 39, as his son, who, legitimated, took the name of his father, real or putative. Another version has it that, with Georg long dead, Nepomuk managed to get the parish records changed by bringing three witnesses to testify that they knew Georg had accepted Alois as his son. A more fanciful version of Adolf Hitler's origins exists, the allegation that his paternal grandfather was Jewish. Its source was the confession by Hans Frank, Governor General of German-occupied Poland, written while awaiting execution at Nuremberg. According to Frank, William Patrick Hitler, the son of Alois Jr., Hitler's half-brother by his father's second wife, had threatened in a letter to divulge Hitler's Jewish ancestry. Hitler asked Frank, then legal advisor to the NSDAP, confidentially to investigate the charge, which Frank claimed to have substantiated, that Maria Schickelgruber's child had been fathered by the 19-year-old son in a household, presumably Jewish, where she had been employed as a domestic. Post-1945 investigations of the local records indicate, however, that no Jews lived in that area at the time, and the story was probably groundless. Still, uncertainties about his own ancestry must have obsessed the man who made ancestry the measure of the Aryan man. Adolf's father was a customs official in the Austrian civil service, and the family moved whenever his assignments were changed. 3 years after Adolf's birth, they moved to Passau, another border town. In 1894, when Adolf was 5 years old, they moved to Leonding, a suburb of Linz, where they finally stayed. Alois retired the next year and spent his time buying and selling farms, strolling about the neighborhood, and socializing at the local tavern. His relations with his son Adolf were stormy and tense. An indifferent and indolent pupil, Adolf was, at his father's insistence, enrolled in the Realschule in Linz, a secondary school whose training would lead to a technical or business career. In sharp conflict with his father, Adolf wanted instead to become a painter, an artist. When Alois died in 1903, the pressure on Adolf ceased. Clara continued to draw her late husband's pension, and Adolf continued his schooling. The next year he was transferred out of the Realschule because of his poor scholastic record. He was enrolled in the Staatsrealschule at Steyr, where he boarded, and which he left in 1905 with indifferent success after completing 4 years of secondary school. The only two subjects in which he excelled were freehand drawing and gymnastics. He failed to take the final examinations and never received a diploma. Years later, one of his teachers described him as lacking self-discipline. Being notoriously cantankerous, willful, arrogant, and bad-tempered. When he returned home from Steyr, his mother sold the house at Leonding and moved with Adolf to Linz proper. Living on her monthly widow's pension and the proceeds of the sale of the house, she supported Adolf, who seemed to have no thought of settling down or looking for work. In Mein Kampf, Hitler minimized the influences on him of his family, friends, and general milieu in Linz. He said he did not remember having heard the word Jew during his father's lifetime, characterizing Alois's views as more or less cosmopolitan. There were just a few Jews in Linz, whom, Adolf said, he regarded merely as Germans of a different religion. He claimed that he did not so much as suspect the existence of an organized opposition to the Jews. His boyhood friend, August Kubitze, remembered otherwise. Alois Hitler, he said, was a supporter of Georg von Schönerer, pan-German nationalist and anti-Semite. One of Hitler's elementary school teachers was said to have been an open anti-Semite, and the Realschule had several teachers with decided anti-Semitic views. According to Kubicek, Hitler himself was a confirmed anti-Semite as early as 1904. While attending the Realschule at Linz, he was reading the local anti-Semitic paper, Linzer Fliegenden Blätter. Furthermore, Linz was where Hitler discovered Wagner as composer and ideologue. He went to the theater to hear Wagner, and in Linz he discovered Wagner's prose writings and no doubt read Jews in Music and the grandiloquent Decay and Regeneration. Wagner, Hitler would later write, stands beside Frederick the Great and Martin Luther. Whoever wants to understand National Socialist Germany must know Wagner. He visited Vienna briefly in 1906 and then managed to convince his doting mother to finance a lengthier trip there to fulfill his ambition of entering the Academy of Fine Arts. In October 1907, he submitted his drawings to the Academy, but they were rejected as unsatisfactory. He stayed in Vienna, living on money sent by his mother, and applied again the following year to the Academy. This time he was not even admitted to the test. Meanwhile, his mother had developed breast cancer and was rapidly succumbing to the disease. On December 21, 1908, she died, and Hitler came home for the funeral. A few weeks later, he left Linz for good and returned to Vienna, where he would live in anonymity for 4 cheerless years. These years in Vienna are the most obscure in Hitler's life. After he spent his modest inheritance and orphan's pension, he had to move into a flophouse. He joined forces with a Reinhold Hannisch, a tramp in the same lodgings. Hitler painted postcards, copying views of Vienna, which Hannisch peddled about town. In 1910, Hitler thought he was being cheated by Hannisch and brought a suit against him. Hannisch was put in jail, and that broke up the partnership. Very little is known of Hitler's life during the next 3 years in Vienna, except that he continued to live the same miserable, marginal existence that he later described as the unhappiest years of his life. In Mein Kampf, he set down the record of how he wanted the development of his intellectual life to appear. Vienna, Hitler said, transformed him into an anti-Semite. For me, this was the time of the greatest spiritual upheaval I have ever had to go through. I had ceased to be a weak-kneed cosmopolitan and became an anti-Semite. The apprenticeship in anti-Semitism that he had served in Linz was glossed over. Hitler wanted his discovery of the truth to be wholly his own, untainted by any influence, especially a paternal one. Still, Vienna was far more decisive than Linz, as the place where his ideas about Jews took shape, and where he began to give serious attention to thoughts of race and racial biology. Hitler dramatized his first confrontation with East European Jews. Once, as I was strolling through the inner city, I suddenly encountered an apparition in a black caftan and black hairlocks. Is this a Jew? Was my first thought. Observing the man, his next question was, is this a German? To find an answer, he turned, as always, to books. I bought the first anti-Semitic pamphlets of my life. But he found the literature unsatisfying. For, he said, it presupposed knowledge or understanding of the Jewish question. Besides, the dull and amazingly unscientific arguments were unconvincing. Only his own study, his own experience, his own slowly rising insights brought him to an understanding of what the Jews were and of the need to combat them. That is, Hitler was saying, without the reinforcement of the then-existent anti-Semitic movement, without prior influences from home, without benefiting from the plenitude of anti-Semitic literature then in the public domain, he himself mastered the Jewish question in the solitary genius of his mind. Vienna was for him, he wrote, the hardest, though most thorough school of his life, where he obtained the foundations for a philosophy in general and a political view in particular, which remained with him for the rest of his life. But outside influences were plainly at work upon him. In Vienna, in Hitler's time, anti-Semitic politics flourished, anti-Semitic organizations proliferated, anti-Semitic writing and propaganda poured forth in an unending stream. Despite his down-and-out flophouse existence, he was aware of much of the anti-Semitic doings. He was, for one, an avid, if unsystematic, reader. He tells us that he read the so-called World Press, the Neue Freie Presse, and the Wiener Tageblatt. Impressed at first, he soon came to see in them, he claimed, the ugly manipulation by the Jews. The hostile attitude the Viennese press took toward Germany particularly vexed him. On this subject, he admitted, I was forced to recognize that one of the anti-Semitic papers, the Deutsches Volksblatt, behaved more decently. The Deutsches Volksblatt was a popular Viennese paper whose appeal was derived from its anti-Semitism, anti-capitalism, and anti-liberalism. Hitler was familiar then with the anti-Semitic press. Perhaps he read it regularly. In fact, by his own admission, he bought and read anti-Semitic pamphlets. Which ones? Of the superabundance of such writings in those days in Vienna, he probably sampled a variety. We know that he was for a time fascinated by the publications of Lanz von Liebenfels, an eccentric occultist racist. Between 1907 and 1910, Lanz published a series of pamphlets called Ostara, Briefbücherei der blonden Mannesrechtler, Newsletters of the Blonde Champions of Man's Rights, in which he depicted the struggle between the blonde Aryan heroes and the dark, hairy ape men representing the lower races. All human existence revolved around this struggle, whose central burden was to preserve the purity of Aryan women from the demonic sexuality of the ape men. Ostara was available at many newsstands, and Hitler had picked up a copy at the corner tobacconist's and then began to buy it regularly. In 1909, he sought out Lanz to get back issues, which Lanz, flattered, provided free of charge. The ape men in Ostara were not always explicitly identified as Jews, perhaps because Lanz thought that the racial conflict as he depicted it was sufficiently lurid to gratify the erotic fantasies of his rootless, unemployed, down-and-out readers, most of whom, like Hitler, were unattached men. With regard to the Jews, Lanz wrote in an issue of Ostara, "We would never dream of preaching pogroms, because they will come without encouragement." Sterilization, the castration knife, would, Lanz held, solve the Jewish problem. The swastika was regarded as a symbol of racial purity, and Ostara dwelt tirelessly on the swastika's origins and secret meanings. Practicing what he preached, Lanz hoisted the swastika over his castle, Burg Werfenstein, in 1907. Besides Ostara, Lanz wrote pamphlets on rare occultism, at least one of which was found in Hitler's private library, Das Buch der Psalmenteutsch, Das Gebetbuch der Arisophen Rassenmystiker und Antisemiten, The Book of Germanic Psalms, Prayer Book of Ariosophic Race Mystics and Antisemites. Another, Das Gesetzbuch der Manu und die Rassenpflege, Manu's Book of Law and Race Cultivation, published in 1908, and hence available to Hitler in those days, advocated that the mongrelized breed of Jews and other inferior beings be wiped from the face of the earth. These horror tales of race defilement and the lurid depiction of the perils confronting Aryan womanhood obviously gratified the young Hitler, feeding his fears and obsessions, personal, sexual, racial. Ostara's influence, or its function as reinforcement, is evident in a much-quoted passage from Mein Kampf. With satanic joy in his face, the black-haired Jewish youth lurks in wait for the unsuspecting girl whom he defiles with his blood, thus stealing her from her people. Another racist pamphleteer whom Hitler read and perhaps also encountered was Guido von Liszt, an indefatigable pseudo-scholarly occultist. During the years that Hitler lived in Vienna, Liszt published several works in which he glorified the ancient Germanic past and extolled the Germanic wisdom in pagan nature, which Christianity, regrettably, had enfeebled. The way to restore the true Germanic life force, Liszt believed, was through the deciphering of ancient runic script and symbols. Like Lanz, Liszt also regarded the swastika as one of the Teutonic mystic symbols, but unlike Lanz, Liszt gave political expression to his racial and ritual occultism. He was associated with Georg von Schönerell's anti-Semitic pan-German movement and wrote for its publication. His political mysticism envisioned a leader who would be reincarnated from the Teutonic warrior heroes. When that leader came, Liszt promised, the Reich would be divided into Gaue districts, each with its own Gauleiter, archaic terminology that the Nazis revived when they came to power. Hitler's Vienna was the locus of two major political movements, Schönerell's Pan-Germans and Karl Lueger's Christian Socials. By the time Hitler came to Vienna, Schönerell, 1842 to 1921, was played out. But 2 decades earlier, he had built the Pan-German movement into a significant force in and beyond Vienna, introducing anti-Semitism as a basic component in the ideology of Pan-Germanism. Lueger was something else. For him, anti-Semitism had become the most successful of all political expedients, and his Christian Social Party showed the greatest political viability of any anti-Semitic movement formed in Germany and Austria after the 1880s. The Viennese adored him, and in election after election after 1895, returned him to the mayoralty. He did not take office till 1897, because both the church and the emperor refused to confirm his election. In Mein Kampf, Hitler discussed both Schönerell and Lueger at length, and dismissed them both. Yet he confessed, when I came to Vienna, my sympathies were fully and wholly on the side of the Pan-German tendency. Those sympathies had been formed in Linz. For when Hitler came to Vienna, Schönerell was then past 65, a has-been. His movement torn by ideological differences and divided over tactics and strategy. Impotent before Lueger's irresistible personality and pragmatic politics. But Schönerell had pioneered in legitimating anti-Semitism in Austrian politics. Still, Hitler is silent about any involvement on his part with the Pan-Germans. He devotes over 20 pages in Mein Kampf to the errors and misjudgments committed by the Pan-Germans. But he concedes in one paltry sentence that they were right on one point, that anti-Semitism of the Pan-German movement was based on a correct understanding of the importance of the racial problem and not on religious ideas. The laconism is understandable. Any elaboration on the correct anti-Semitic doctrines of the Pan-German movement would expose Hitler's intellectual and ideological borrowings. As for Karl Lueger's Christian social movement, Hitler praised its tactics but condemned its wrong approach to anti-Semitism and its disinterest in German nationalism. Lueger, he believed, did not properly understand the Jewish danger, and his anti-Semitism was flawed because it was based on religious ideas instead of racial knowledge. That, Hitler thought, was no way to combat the Jews. If the worst came to the worst, a splash of baptismal water could always save the business and the Jew at the same time. The Christian socials, Hitler asserted, engaged in sham anti-Semitism. Hitler had a point. Lueger, the master of pragmatic politics, regarded anti-Semitism primarily as a political tactic rather than an evangelistic doctrine. His classic statement that must have been familiar to Hitler was, "Wer Jude ist, das bestimme ich." Who is a Jew, that I decide. Hitler never mentions that he belonged to any political party or organization in Vienna. Yet, given his ideas, it seems strange that he did not seek out some kindred group, or even stumble upon one of the numerous societies that made anti-Semitism the center of their activity. As a matter of fact, Kubitschek asserted that one day in 1908, Hitler came into their room with the announcement, "Hey, today I became a member of the anti-Semitic Bund, and I enrolled you too." Perhaps, indeed, Hitler did drift into some small anti-Semitic group composed of down-and-outers like himself, misfits and malcontents who gathered to talk about the vile conspiracies afoot in Vienna for which the Jews were responsible. Perhaps it was a group that failed to recognize or acknowledge Hitler's abilities. "In my little circle," Hitler writes in Mein Kampf, "I talked my tongue sore and my throat hoarse, but to no avail." But, he confesses, "speaking in the narrowest circles, he gained experience. I learned to orate less." But perhaps Hitler deliberately failed to mention any organizational affiliations he may have had, because he wanted to preserve the classic legend of the man in the making, the political leader who reaches political maturity while having protected his political virginity. "Today, it is my conviction that in general, a man should not engage in public political activity before his 30th year," he wrote in Mein Kampf. "Otherwise, he runs the risk of either having to change his former position on essential questions, or of clinging to a view which reason and conviction have long since discarded." Hitler was exactly 30 when he joined the Deutsche Arbeiterpartei in Munich in 1919. What he learned about Jews in the Vienna period, as recorded in a brief span of 10 pages of Mein Kampf, years of study and suffering in Vienna, is a mere foreshadowing of the ideas to come. Images of the Jew as unclean predominate. Unclean dress, physical uncleanness. Jews were at the heart of everything that was diseased. They were to blame for prostitution in Vienna and the white slave traffic. Psychoanalysts suggest here a projection of his guilt feelings about his sexual fantasies. He had discovered that Jews dominated the liberal press in Vienna and the city's cultural and artistic life, that they were behind the social democratic movement, Marxism. Triumphantly, he had at last found an answer to the original question he had posed about the Jew. The Jew was no German. With this intellectual baggage, the claptrap of the conventional anti-Semitism of the time, and deep fears of political democracy, Hitler left Vienna in May 1913 and came to Munich, the Mecca of Germandom. He arrived in Munich, a rootless young man of 24, without friends, without family, without career or occupation, in a restless search for his identity, or, as he would have put it, his destiny. He found a room with a tailor's family in a working-class quarter of Munich and continued the same hand-to-mouth existence he had led in Vienna, peddling sketches and drawings. He continued the anti-Semitic racist studies he had begun in Vienna, reading the papers and pamphlets, observing. He seems to have become more aggressive, more confident, speaking publicly in taverns and beer cellars. He had already cast himself as prophet. In the years 1913 and 1914, I, for the first time in various circles which today, in part, faithfully support the National Socialist movement, expressed the conviction that the question of the future of the German nation was the question of destroying Marxism. What various circles? Hitler makes them appear to have been more than a casual congregation of beer drinkers in a tavern. Did he perhaps belong to a National Socialist forerunner group? Of the various nationalist and anti-Semitic groups in Munich, there were at least two proto-Nazi organizations he might have belonged to or frequented. The Germanen- und Welsungsorden, Order of Teutons and Volsungs, founded in 1912 as a Masonic-style racist society, is a possibility. One of its offshoots or branches was called Amanenorden, and the inscription to Hitler found in a book in his private library supports the idea of such membership. It regarded its central function to be the struggle against the secret Jewish conspiracy. The Germanenorden was replete with Teutonic vocabulary and symbols. Its journal, Runen, was decorated with swastikas. Another group that Hitler could have joined would have been the local Munich branch of Theodor Fritsch's Reichshammerbund, a minuscule network of 19 discussion and propaganda groups throughout Germany, closely associated with the Germanenorden. As for Fritsch, he was the grand old man of anti-Semitic propaganda, and it is inconceivable that Hitler could have failed to have read his classic work, Antisemitenkatechismus, Anti-Semites Catechism, later entitled Handbuch der Judenfrage, which went through innumerable editions. Still, if Hitler actually ever belonged to any group, he made no lasting associations. In later years, no one came forward with reminiscences that could locate him in any specific anti-Semitic organization. Though Mein Kampf indicates that he had become more confident of himself and had found places to frequent that were attuned to his ideas, he still appeared to have retained the characteristics of an eccentric loner. The assassination of Ferdinand at Sarajevo unleashed World War I, and the war unleashed the pent-up nihilistic impulses that were raging within Hitler. The sense of approaching catastrophe turned at last to longing. Let heaven at last give free rein to the fate which could no longer be thwarted. On August 1, 1914, the declaration proclaiming war was read in Munich's Odeonsplatz before a flag-waving, anthem-singing assembled mass. A photograph that later came to light showed Hitler in the crowd, eyes popping, mouth open, wildly exultant. 2 days later, he submitted a petition to Ludwig III, the last king of Bavaria, to join a Bavarian regiment. The request was approved. For me, as for every German, there now began the greatest and most unforgettable time of my earthly existence. He fought in France, was wounded, received the Iron Cross, second class, returned to the front, was wounded a second time. Then, fighting at the front again, he was promoted to Lance Corporal and fought again in France. October 1918, blinded in a British gas attack, he was sent to a military hospital. That last year he received the Iron Cross, first class, a decoration seldom given to a soldier of his low rank, though no one knows for what act of bravery it was presented. While at the hospital, he witnessed the Bavarian Revolution of November 1918, led by Kurt Eisner, the overthrow of the monarchy, the armistice, and the creation, in weakness and indecision, of the Weimar Republic, in his mind, all the work of the Jews. It was then, Hitler recollected, that he decided to go into politics. He returned to Munich, where the following April he saw the establishment of a Soviet republic, and then, within a month, its suppression in blood by the Reichswehr. He got a job as educational officer, the first real job he ever had, in the press and propaganda office of the political department of the District Army Command in Munich. The department's function was to indoctrinate Reichswehr recruits on the dangers of radicalism. Hitler had become an employee in the very center of the military apparatus that would help undermine the new republic. He was called on to submit reports on various political organizations active in the Munich area. In 1919, he was assigned to cover a newly formed group called the Deutsche Arbeiterpartei, German Workers' Party. He joined the group. On February 24, 1920, its name was changed to Nationalsozialistische Deutsche Arbeiterpartei, NSDAP. When the new 25-point program that Hitler had drafted was adopted. In the immediate post-war years in Munich, Hitler's social life changed drastically from his pre-war solitariness. He was in contact with several circles of like-minded people, and those associations gave him certitude and reassurance. Under a variety of influences, people, books, and pamphlets, his ideas about race and about Jews crystallized. He had come to Munich with much of his anti-Jewish racist ideology already formed. He had emerged from the war still more politically paranoid, wildly blaming the Jews for the Dolchstoß, for that treacherous stab in the back that made the Germans lose the war. Still, the influences in Munich were decisive, for they would make it possible for him to cast his ideas into one coherent system. One group with which he early came into contact was the Thule Society, a conspiratorial front for the post-war incarnation of the Germanenorden, which was involved in assassination attempts on Eisner and the leaders of the Munich Soviet. Besides counter-revolutionary violence, the Thule Society engaged in folkist racist propaganda. Its members included Rudolf Hess, who was to become Hitler's most slavish follower, Karl Harrer, a co-founder of the Deutsche Arbeiterpartei, and Dietrich Eckart, an important influence on Hitler in those early Munich days. Eckart, 1868 to 1923, was the one man whom Hitler acknowledged as mentor and teacher, closing the second volume of Mein Kampf with a tribute to him. That man, one of the best, who devoted his life to the awakening of his, our people, in his writings and his thoughts, and finally in his deeds. Eckart, in his rootlessness and agitated mental state, was an elder version of Hitler, but was more bohemian, addicted to alcohol and drugs. An unsuccessful playwright, he blamed the Jews for his failure. During the war, he moved to Munich, barely managed to control his addictions, and became the bard of the folkist movement. In 1919, he began publishing Auf gut Deutsch, a weekly replete with folkist anti-Semitism, continuing until early 1921, when Hitler appointed him editor of the Völkische Beobachter. One of Eckart's pamphlets, Der Bolschewismus von Moses bis Lenin, Zwiegespräch zwischen Adolf Hitler und mir, Bolshevism from Moses to Lenin, Dialogue between Adolf Hitler and me, published posthumously, has been adduced as an example of Eckart's influence on Hitler's ideas prior to Mein Kampf. Eckart took Hitler under his wing, showed him the ropes, introduced him to influential and wealthy nationalists and proto-Nazis. In 1920, Eckart took Hitler with him on a flight to Berlin to join up with the right-wing KAP putsch just before it collapsed. But Eckhart's most lasting contribution to Hitler's intellectual development was merely coincidental. It was he who introduced Alfred Rosenberg to Hitler. Rosenberg, the Baltic German whom Hitler would later ridicule and despise, enlarged Hitler's intellectual horizons, stretching his concepts beyond the borders of Germany. Rosenberg was one of those many Russian émigrés from the Bolshevik Revolution who imported into Western Europe the anti-Semitic notions of Tsarist Russia's Black Hundred, beat the Jews and save Russia, and commingled the anti-Semitism of Russia's darkest reaction with the anti-Semitism of Germany's paranoid nationalism. Rosenberg was born into a family of middle-class German Balts in 1893, in Reval, Tallinn, a Hanseatic city that, since the early 18th century, had been part of the Russian Empire. In 1910, he was admitted to the Institute of Technology in Riga, where he studied architecture. In 1915, when the German front advanced, the institute was evacuated to Moscow, and Rosenberg went along with the complement of faculty and students. In January 1918, he received his diploma and returned home. His world collapsed when the revolution erupted. He started his peregrinations and finally left Russia with the retreating German army that had been in occupation. When Rosenberg came to Munich, his interests were no longer cultural, but political. The politics of reaction and counter-revolution. Like many another Russian émigré, he had brought with him a booklet that utterly possessed him, The Protocols of the Elders of Zion. An implausible forgery concocted by the Tsarist secret police at the turn of the century, it purported to disclose the secret plans of the so-called international Jewish conspiracy for world domination. It was incomparably done, Hitler was to write in Mein Kampf. The Protocols first appeared in German in 1920 and was constantly being reprinted thereafter. Rosenberg made something of a name for himself as a German commentator on the Protocols, writing innumerable articles and pamphlets on the subject. His higher education, his penchant for wide-ranging philosophic schemas, and the scope of his philosophic reading admirably equipped Rosenberg for the role of Hitler's intellectual mentor. From 19th-century West European thought, Fichte, Schopenhauer, Nietzsche, Gobineau, and Houston Stuart Chamberlain, Rosenberg took those ideas of nation, folk, nationalism, race, the rise and fall of civilizations, and conjoined them all with the crude and superstitious anti-Semitic and anti-Bolshevik ideas that the Russian émigrés had been nurtured on in their mother country. Chamberlain, Rosenberg confessed years later, was the strongest positive impulse in my youth. And it is no surprise that Rosenberg was said to have prepared, for Hitler's easy study, excerpts from Chamberlain's Die Grundlagen des 19. Jahrhunderts, Foundations of the 19th Century. Russian-speaking and authoritative about Russian culture and politics, Rosenberg became Hitler's mentor also on Russia and Bolshevism. He inducted Hitler into the domain of international relations and prepared him for the geopolitical concepts he would pick up from Rudolf Hess and Hess's teacher and friend, Karl Haushofer. Haushofer, general turned professor, likely introduced Hitler to the concept of space as a factor of power, but Rosenberg elaborated the idea of Lebensraum, living space, which was to become a cornerstone of National Socialist ideology and one of the chief objectives of Germany's foreign policy. Those early days in Munich were no doubt Rosenberg's finest. Hitler would never again regard him so seriously. While the international aspects of National Socialist ideology were still germinating within him, Hitler's general ideas about the Jews were fixed by 1920. In a letter dated September 16, 1919, and written at the request of his military superior in the Press and Propaganda Office, in reply to one Adolf Gemlich, who asked for enlightenment on the Jewish question, Hitler set forth some of the ideas that in Mein Kampf he claimed to have already discovered in Vienna. Anti-Semitism, as a political movement, he wrote, cannot and should not be determined by emotional factors, but on the contrary, by an understanding of the facts. The facts, he continued, are that, in the first instance, Jewry is without question a race and not a religious fellowship. He then expatiated on the alleged Jewish single-minded pursuit of money and power, touching on the already classic anti-Semitic notion that Jews dominate, falsify, and exploit the press. The effect of Jewry will be racial tuberculosis of nations. In Mein Kampf, in the same context, he wrote, it was no accident that man mastered the plague more easily than tuberculosis. From his analysis, Hitler concluded that anti-Semitism, grounded merely in emotion, would find its ultimate outlet in pogroms. That was not enough. Rational anti-Semitism, however, must lead to a systematic legal opposition and elimination of the special privileges which Jews hold. In contrast to the other aliens living among us, aliens' legislation. Its final objective must unswervingly be the removal, Entfernung, of the Jews altogether. That paragraph carries in the post-Auschwitz world a staggering freight. It prefigures the political realities of the German dictatorship under Hitler, when the Jews were deprived of all rights systematically and legally, and then removed altogether. The ambiguity of the word removal now more apparent than it was in 1919. Hitler made his first public speech at a meeting of the Deutsche Arbeiterpartei on November 13, 1919, in a Munich beer cellar, and soon began to attract large audiences. Invariably, he held forth on Germany's defeat in the war, which he blamed on Jewish treachery. On April 29, 1920, the subject of his address was Jewry, and according to the summary in an army political report, he concluded with a promise. We will carry on the struggle until the last Jew is removed from the German Reich. On August 13, 1920, he spoke at an NSDAP public meeting in a large hall on the topic, Why Are We Anti-Semites? The text of which has recently been published. That speech differed in one respect from Mein Kampf in that it was directed toward working people and stressed the need for social and economic reform. Exalting labor, Hitler followed an old anti-Semitic tradition, asserting that Jews degraded and exploited labor. His evidence was the Pentateuchal injunction, "In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread," which he interpreted to mean that the Jews regarded labor as a curse from God. But in addressing himself to the subject of race and of Jews, the speech laid out the basic concepts that he was to develop in Mein Kampf. He emphasized the need for a political organization to combat the Jews. It was not enough, he claimed, to deprive them of their economic power. The campaign for social reform must be accompanied by a struggle against the opponents of any social measures, Jewry. The solution to the Jewish question must be removal, Entfernung, of the Jews from our nation, not because we would begrudge them their existence. We congratulate the rest of the world on their company, but because the existence of our own nation is a thousand times more important to us than that of an alien race. During his enforced political inactivity in Landsberg prison, Hitler undertook to put his ideas together in Mein Kampf, which was autobiography, ideological doctrine, and party manual all in one. In Mein Kampf, he expounded on race as the central principle of human existence and explicated the relationship, since the start of time, between the two world adversaries, the Aryans and the Jews. The racial question, he wrote, gives the key not only to world history, but to all human culture. For, he believed, in the blood alone resides the strength as well as the weakness of man. All great questions of the day he held to be momentary and derivative. Only the question of racial preservation of the nation was determinative. Only that was significant as a causal factor in the rise and fall of civilization. An understanding of the Jewish problem was a prerequisite for an understanding of the racial problem. The resurrection of Germany would never be achieved without the clearest knowledge of the racial problem and hence of the Jewish problem. The Aryan race was the bearer of human cultural development, and consequently, human culture and civilization are inseparably bound up with the presence of the Aryan. The Aryans, therefore, by their nature, their blood, were chosen to rule the world. The very existence of world civilization depended on maintaining and safeguarding the purity of the Aryan race. What we must fight for is to safeguard the existence and reproduction of our race and our people, the sustenance of our children and the purity of our blood, the freedom and independence of the fatherland, so that our people may mature for the fulfillment of the mission allotted it by the Creator of the universe. The state, according to Hitler, existed merely as a means to an end, the preservation of the racial community. States that did not serve that purpose were misbegotten monstrosities. The folkist state must set race in the center of all life, for it is thus acting as the guardian of a millennial future. The mission of the German people is the formation of such a folkist state, which will have the task not only of assembling and preserving the most valuable stocks of basic racial elements in this people, but slowly and surely of raising them to a dominant position. But the obstacle, or threat, to the fulfillment of this racial millennium is the Jew. The mightiest counterpart to the Aryan is represented by the Jew. In Hitler's system, the Aryans represented the perfection of human existence, whereas the Jews were the embodiment of evil. Wer kennt den Jude, kennt den Teufel, the saying went. Whoever knows the Jew knows the devil. Indeed, Hitler wrote, the vileness of the Jew is so gigantic that no one need be surprised if among our people the personification of the devil as the symbol of all evil assumes the living shape of the Jews. The Jew as outsider, as the other, had been transformed into the ultimate evil. The vileness of the Jew, he claimed, resided in the blood of the race and was evident in the Jew's physical, mental, cultural being. This vileness, Hitler declared, had permeated nearly every aspect of modern society. Over and over again, he kept describing the Jews in terms of filth and disease. If the Jews were alone in this world, they would stifle in filth and offal. Jews, he asserted, were at the center of every abscess, were germ carriers, poisoning the blood of others, but preserving their own. The Jews were, Hitler said, a ferment of decomposition, quoting a phrase used by Theodor Mommsen, which, out of context, had become an anti-Semitic platitude. The depiction of the Jews as the carriers of filth and disease, and hence of death and destruction, goes back in the history of anti-Semitism to the Middle Ages, when Jews were accused of spreading the plague and poisoning the wells. As late as the 17th century, a pestilence in Vienna was readily explained. It is well known that such pestilential epidemics are caused by evil spirits by Jews, by gravediggers, and by witches. Hitler accused the Jews particularly of sexual defilement and even blamed them for the presence of syphilis in post-war Germany. Nor did Hitler disregard cultural pollution. Was there any form of filth or profligacy, particularly in cultural life, without at least one Jew involved in it? The poison of the press, allegedly controlled by the Jews, was able to penetrate the bloodstream of our people. From the concept of the Jew as parasite, vampire, bloodsucker, contaminating the Aryan race, it was but a small step to the Jew as figurative bloodsucker in the financial and economic spheres. The spider was slowly beginning to suck the blood out of the people's pores through the war corporations. That image had its source in the leftist anti-Semitic stereotype of the mid and late 19th century. How had the Jews succeeded in insinuating themselves into the body of the Aryan race? By gigantic fraud and deception, Hitler said. By the first and greatest lie that the Jews are a religious community, while actually they are a race. And what a race! As Hitler saw it, the Mosaic religion is nothing other than a doctrine for the preservation of the Jewish race. He believed that the Jews had no language or culture of their own, that they sapped and drained other cultures and races so as ultimately to destroy them. That way, Hitler maintained, the Jews would achieve dominion over the world. It is the inexorable Jew who struggles for his domination over the nations. The Jews had many conspiratorial techniques and vehicles for achieving world mastery, Hitler said. And in modern society, these were Freemasonry, the press, democracy, parliamentarianism, the trade union movement, Marxism, and social democracy. As for democracy, he held that only the Jew can praise an institution which is as dirty and false as he himself. The Jewish doctrine of Marxism, Hitler contended, rejects the aristocratic principle of nature. The goal of Marxism is and remains the destruction of all non-Jewish national states. Marxism itself, Hitler believed, systematically plans to hand the world over to the Jews. He did not have to scour long for evidence. The best proof for his argument was what had happened in Russia, or rather, to Russia. Hitler's association of the Jews with Russian Bolshevism, an idea fostered and insisted on by Rosenberg, was, in its delusional conclusion, more original than his other ideas about Jews and race that derived from the ample sources of European antisemitism and racial doctrine. That the Jews were the revolutionaries par excellence, the masterminds of the Bolshevik Revolution, that was nothing new. The reality of Leon Trotsky and the forgery of the protocols documented that charge to the satisfaction of most antisemites. But Hitler went beyond this and penetrated beneath the surface of the conspiracy. In Russian Bolshevism, we must see the attempt undertaken by the Jews in the 20th century to achieve world domination. All Russia, he believed, had somehow become captive of the Jews. Schooled by Rosenberg, Hitler had concluded that the Slavs were an inferior race, incapable of building a state. For centuries, Hitler explained, Russia drew nourishment from the Germanic nucleus of its upper leading strata. But those strata, exterminated and extinguished, were then replaced by the Jews. A similar fate, he warned, faced Germany, unless it would show sufficient national will to resist. Since the Russians, according to Hitler's view, could never by themselves shake off Jewish domination, the Russian Empire must necessarily collapse. Having reached this point in the development of his ideas about Russia, Hitler then elaborated his doctrines of race and space that culminated in his foreign policy program for a National Socialist Germany. Spurning with contempt the suggestion that Germany ought to conclude an alliance with the Soviet Union, Hitler solemnly declared, "The fight against Jewish world Bolshevization requires a clear attitude towards Soviet Russia. You cannot drive out the devil with Beelzebub." That metaphor was one of Hitler's favorites all his life, but he used it expediently. In a speech on April 6, 1920, he was reported to have said that in order to achieve the National Socialist goal of extirpating the evil, the Jews, that is, root and branch, "every means is justified, even when we must ally ourselves with the devil." Mein Kampf is a vision of the apocalyptic conflict between the Aryans and the Jews, of the two world systems struggling for dominion. It was his own Manichaean version of the conflict between good and evil, between God and the devil, Christ and the Antichrist. He saw himself as the Messiah, who would bring deliverance from the devil. "Hence, today I believe that I am acting in accordance with the will of the Almighty Creator. By defending myself against the Jew, I am fighting for the work of the Lord." Some years later, Hitler told Rauschning, "We are God's people." He repeated what he had written in Mein Kampf. "Two worlds face one another, the men of God and the men of Satan. The Jew is the anti-man, the creature of another God. He must have come from another root of the human race. I set the Aryan and the Jew over and against each other." The Jews inhabited Hitler's mind. He believed that they were the source of all evil, misfortune, and tragedy, the single factor that, like some inexorable law of nature, explained the workings of the universe, the irregularities of war and famine, financial distress and sudden death, defeat and sinfulness, all could be explained by the presence of that single factor in the universe, a miscreation that disturbed the world's steady ascent toward well-being, affluence, success, victory. A savior was needed to come forth and slay the loathsome monster. In Hitler's obsessed mind, as in the delusive imaginings of the medieval millenarian sectarians, the Jews were the demonic hosts whom he had been given a divine mission to destroy. All his life, Hitler was seized by this obsession with the Jews. Even after he had murdered the Jews, he had still not exorcised his Jewish demons. At 4 a.m. on April 29, 1945, the last day of his life in the Berlin bunker, he finished dictating his political testament. His last words to the German people were, "Above all, I charge the leaders of the nation and those under them to scrupulous observance of the laws of race and to merciless opposition to the universal poisoner of all peoples, international Jewry." The question continues to oppress us. How could a man with this poor baggage of deranged ideas and prejudices become Chancellor of Germany? How was it possible that a state whose people and culture ranked high in the world's civilization should have entrusted its fate to this deluded man who believed that he had been chosen to lead a holy war against the Jews? Many answers have been given, and perhaps many are needed, for no single theory can satisfactorily explain Hitler's phenomenal success with the German people. They were mesmerized by his voice, and they responded to his message. Was it because their moral sense, at least with regard to the Jews, had become atrophied under the effect of generations of virulent anti-Semitism? Had the German people already become mithridatized by anti-Semitic poison, so that they had become immune even to Hitler's deadly brand? Was it because he spoke for them? 2. Anti-Semitism in modern Germany. A line of anti-Semitic descent from Martin Luther to Adolf Hitler is easy to draw, Both Luther and Hitler were obsessed by a demonologized universe inhabited by Jews. "No, Christian," wrote Luther, "that next to the devil thou hast no enemy more cruel, more venomous, and violent than a true Jew." Hitler himself, in that early dialogue with Dietrich Eckart, asserted that the later Luther, that is, the violently anti-Semitic Luther, was the genuine Luther. Luther's protective authority was invoked by the Nazis when they came to power, and his anti-Semitic writings enjoyed a revival of popularity. To be sure, the similarities of Luther's anti-Jewish exhortations with modern racial anti-Semitism, and even with Hitler's racial policies, are not merely coincidental. They all derive from a common historic tradition of Jew hatred, whose provenance can be traced back to Haman's advice to Ahasuerus. But modern German antisemitism had more recent roots than Luther and grew out of a different soil. Not that German antisemitism was new. It drew part of its sustenance from Christian antisemitism, whose foundation had been laid by the Catholic Church and upon which Luther built. It was equally a product of German nationalism. Modern German antisemitism was the bastard child of the union of Christian antisemitism with German nationalism. German nationalism arose out of the ashes of German defeat in the Napoleonic Wars. Fragmented, without nationhood, without political definition, lacking military power and economic vitality, the Germans searched for a shared identity that would restore the self-esteem that the defeats by the French had shattered. Since the real world, in its materiality, its politics, economics, and the force of arms, could give them no solace, they turned inward for self-definition, in search of psychic and metaphysical values, qualities of feeling and spirit. And they turned backward to a remote past of glory and mastery, to a past deep in the womb of historic time, where they had once been secure. This German backward-lookingness had emerged even before the Napoleonic Wars, in the last quarter of the 18th century, as a reaction against the Enlightenment, especially its French and English protagonists. The Enlightenment represented the break with the medieval world and its concept of man's innate sinfulness, whose only hope of salvation was through divine providence. For this worldview, the Enlightenment substituted the idea of progress, of man's perfectibility through the attainment of knowledge, and the theory that the universe was governed by reason. This idea of progress was to catch hold particularly among the French and the English, not only among the philosophers and sociologists, but in political circles as well. In Germany, these ideas spread too, but they were soon aborted by Germany's dominant conservative forces. The Holy Roman Empire, a paralytic, sclerotic, thousand-year survival, managed to exist propped up by the strength of tradition and the inertia of apathy. The Germans preferred to retain their loyalties to the past and resisted accommodation of their customs and folkways to the enormous changes of modernity. Instead, they romanticized the values and ideals of their remote past. This commitment to the past explains the German preference for Kultur over Zivilisation. Culture was for them something innate, intrinsic, inherited, a tradition handed down from the past. Civilization was external, an artificial product of modernity, lacking the essence of a specific people, race, or culture. Progress and enlightenment were associated not only with the French and English, but also with Jews. Invoking the universality of these concepts, Jews asked for emancipation, political equality. All France was astir over the pros and cons. The Alsatian Jews asked Moses Mendelssohn, then Europe's most eminent Jew, to help them, believing that a plea for Jewish emancipation would have a better reception if presented by a Christian, Mendelssohn asked his friend, Christian Wilhelm von Dohm, 1751 to 1820, historian, political writer, and Prussian diplomat, to undertake the task. Dohm decided to extend his plea also on behalf of the German Jews. His work, Über die bürgerliche Verbesserung der Juden, On the Civic Betterment of the Jews, Berlin, 1781, presented the case for granting Jews political equality. Its basic argument was the extraordinary notion that the Jew is a human being even before he is a Jew. But the idea was too radical for the Germans. Most participants in the ensuing public discussion disagreed with Dohm's belief that the Jews would become better citizens if the conditions under which they lived were improved. Adducing traditional medieval objections and citing scripture, or the devil, as evidence, some maintained that the Jews were unfit for emancipation and that there was no reason to think that things would change in the future. Others presented the argument of Asiatic temperament. Certain basic racial qualities inhered in Jews that were at variance with those of Germans. This fundamental difference between German and Jew was cited also, to the astonishment of Moses Mendelssohn, by Johann David Michaelis, 1717-1791, an aged, prestigious scholar of Biblical, Old Testament, and Mosaic law at the University of Göttingen. Mendelssohn replied to Michaelis and other opponents of Jewish emancipation in classical terms. Instead of using the expression Christians and Jews, Herr Michaelis is continually served by Germans and Jews. He refuses to recognize that the difference is in religion only, and prefers to have us regarded as foreigners who must accept the conditions laid down to them by the owners of the land. Being himself a man of progress and enlightenment, he could not then, in 1783, foretell that.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.